So in the last class, we discussed about the molecular orbital theory, right? So we just started the molecular orbital theory, and we finished with the main postulates of the molecular orbital theory and the linear combination of atomic orbitals. Yes, up to this we finished right in the class about the bonding molecular orbital and the anti-bonding molecular orbital. Any doubts in this? So just we will revise once again what we discussed in the last class. So in the case of atomic orbitals, the electrons will revolve under the influence of only one atom. But in the case of molecular orbital, the electrons will revolve under the influence of multiple nuclei present in the given molecule, right? So all the electrons will combine in the given molecule and will form the circular path around the combined nuclei, and all the electrons will revolve around the combined nuclei in the circular path. That circular path is called as a molecular orbital. The next point is the atomic orbitals of comparable energy and proper symmetry only will combine to form the molecular orbitals. So all the atomic orbitals will not combine to form the molecular orbitals. Only the atomic orbitals having the comparable energies and the having the proper symmetry only, they will combine to form the molecular orbitals. So if you take example like 2px and 2px only will combine to form the molecular orbital. 2px and 2pz will not combine because they both have a different symmetry and different plane of axis. So both will have the different symmetry now and different directions. So they will not combine 2px and 2pz. The third point is whenever the electrons in the atomic orbital is influenced by one nucleus, in the molecular orbital it is influenced by two or more nuclei, depending upon the number of atoms in the molecule. That just we discussed this now. And the fourth one is the number of molecular orbitals formed is equal to the number of atomic orbitals combined. The number of molecular orbitals formation will depend upon the number of atomic orbitals combined only. Suppose if you are combining two atomic orbitals, it will form the two molecular orbitals. And again, molecular orbitals are two different types. One is a bonding molecular orbital, the other one is anti-bonding molecular orbital. So we'll get the bonding molecular orbital when we add the two waves or two atomic orbitals. We'll get the anti-bonding molecular orbital when we are adding the when we are subtracting the wave function of the two atomic orbitals, you will get the anti-bonding molecular orbitals. And when you are adding the wave function of the atomic orbitals, you will get the bonding molecular orbitals. Sigma and the sigma star. Sigma indicates the bonding molecular orbital, and sigma star indicates the anti-bonding molecular orbital. Sigma equal to psi A plus psi B, and sigma star is equal to psi A minus psi B. The next important point is the bonding molecular orbitals are having lower energy compared to the atomic orbitals. That's why the bonding molecular orbital is more stable than the atomic orbitals and the anti-bonding orbitals. So if you see this point, can you see one image here? This is the stable energy diagram. Okay, 1 minute, please. And this is the energy diagram. So if you see, this is the atomic orbital of A. Suppose you take hydrogen and hydrogen. Two hydrogens are combining to form the H2 molecule. Okay. So this is a hydrogen, and hydrogen having only one electron in the outermost shell, that is a 1s. 1s1, and this is also having 1s1. So this is the atomic orbital of first hydrogen, A hydrogen. This is the atomic orbital of second hydrogen. Okay, these are the atomic orbitals. When you combine these two atomic orbitals, it will form two molecular orbitals. This is the first molecular orbital, this is the second molecular orbital. And the first molecular orbital is psi sigma. That is a bonding molecular orbital. Psi A plus psi B. And the second molecular orbital is anti-bonding molecular orbitals, that is sigma star. Psi A minus psi B. So if you see the increasing of energy, it will increase in this format, right? So bottom to top, it will increase. That means this will have the lower energy. And it is a bonding molecular orbital. This is the atomic energy, atomic orbitals having the intermediate energy. And these are the anti-bonding molecular orbitals. These are the anti-bonding molecular orbitals which are having very high energy. So compared to the atomic orbitals, anti-bonding molecular orbitals will have the high energy. And compared to atomic orbitals, bonding molecular orbitals are having the low energy. Understanding from this diagram, when you are combining two atomic orbitals, it will form two molecular orbitals. One with lower energy than the atomic orbitals, the other with the higher energy for the atomic orbitals. The lower energy atomic molecular orbitals is called as an bonding molecular orbitals, and the higher energy molecular orbitals is called as an anti-bonding molecular orbitals. Okay, so any doubts in the energy structure? Is it clear, or can I explain once again? Anjali, Abhinaya, and Pravalika.
Sir, it is clear, sir.
What about the remaining two?
Yes, sir, understood.
So which one will have the higher energy? Anti-bonding atomic orbitals or the bonding or molecular orbitals? Which one will have the higher energy?
Molecular orbitals?
Molecular orbitals also, in that only one will have the higher energy, right?
Yes, sir. Only one will have in that.
Then which
other
one
will have the lowest energy?
Then which one is having the higher energy and which one is having the lower energy?
The anti-bonding orbital.
What is it? Anti-bonding molecular orbitals will have the higher energy, and the bonding molecular orbitals will have the lower energy. Any doubts in this?
No, sir.
Just take the screenshot of this and you can copy this one in the classwork notes. And this molecular orbital theory, I'm going to explain in the textbook itself. That's better, because with the diagrams, is everything is given in the textbook now, it will be easy to understand. Okay, so just take the screenshot of this and you can copy in that. The energy level diagrams in the molecular orbitals, that is the side heading. Energy level diagram in the molecular orbitals. Finish. Clear, right?
Yes, sir.
Can I clear all the writing part?
Yes, sir.
So when you're combining the two atomic orbitals, it will form two molecular orbitals like this. Okay, these are the atomic orbitals, these two. So you are combining two atomic orbitals, now it will form two molecular orbitals. So this is a bonding molecular orbital, which is having lower energy than the atomic orbitals. This is a anti-bonding molecular orbitals, which is having higher energy than the atomic orbitals. Okay. So that is a simple diagram for the all the things what we discussed till now. Clear, right? The bonding molecular orbital having lower energy and greater stability than the corresponding anti-bonding molecular orbital. Any doubts in the fifth point? Any doubts in this?
No, sir.
Similarly, the anti-bonding molecular orbital is having higher energy and having the less stability than the corresponding molecular orbital. You can write that point also, right? Opposite of this. Okay, sixth point is, just as electron probability distribution around the nucleus in the orbital, sorry, in the atom, is given by the atomic orbital. The electron probability distribution around the group of nuclei in the given molecule is called as a molecular orbital. That means, if you take the, this is the nucleus part, and these are the atomic orbital having both wave function and the particle like nature. Okay, there is an atomic orbital where the probability of finding the electron is maximum. Okay, where the probability of finding the electron is maximum, that is called as an atomic orbital. But if you take group of the nuclei, and this is the molecular orbital, where the probability of finding the electron is maximum around the combined nuclei is called as a molecular orbital. So it will also have the both particle-like nature and the wave-like nature. So it is only explained in the sixth point. The electron probability distribution around the nucleus in an atom is given by atomic orbitals. In the same way, the electron probability distribution around the group of nuclei in the molecule is given by the molecular orbitals. That is the sixth point. Okay. Any doubts in the sixth point? Any doubts in the sixth point? What about the seventh one? The molecular orbitals like atomic orbitals are filled according with the Hofbauer principle, Pauli's exclusion principle, and the Hund's rule. I hope you know all the three principles. What is the Hofbauer principle, Pauli's exclusion principle, and the Hund's rule? What is the Hofbauer principle, Pauli's exclusion principle, and the Hund's rule? Please tell me fast. What is the answer? Hofbauer principle means you have the chart, right? Based upon the n plus l values, you will distribute the electrons to the each orbital. That is the Hofbauer principle. So 1s, 2s, the chart will be there. And Pauli's exclusion principle is what? Before pairing of electrons, we have to give each electron to the each orbital, degenerate orbitals, before pairing starts. That is a Pauli's exclusion principle. And the Hund's rule is, whenever you are giving the electrons, the two electrons in the orbital should not have the same set of quantum numbers, same set of four quantum numbers. Only three quantum numbers should be same, and the fourth spin quantum number should be different. So these two rules will follow for the atomic orbitals during the filling of the electrons in those atomic orbitals. The same rules also will follow in the filling of electrons in the molecular orbitals. That is only explained here. Okay. So these are the 7 points of the molecular orbital theory. And last class also discussed about this, how the formation of sigma, psi A plus psi B and all. If you add the two wave functions of the atomic orbitals, it will form the bonding molecular orbital. And if you subtract the wave functions of two atomic orbitals, it will form the antibonding molecular orbitals. For that, we don't use the method Schrodinger wave equation, but for this we'll use a different method that is called as a linear combination of atomic orbitals. So adding of electrons and subtraction of atomic orbitals, all we'll do with the help of LCAO method, that is a linear combination of atomic orbitals. Okay. So that is all about the linear combination of atomic orbitals, but there are some conditions are there for the combination of atomic orbitals. The first one is the combining atomic orbitals must have the same or nearly the same energy. So to form the molecular orbitals, you have to combine the atomic orbitals, right? So for the conditions are there for the combination of atomic orbitals also. What is the first one in that? The combining atomic orbitals must have the same or the nearly the same energy. That means 1s atomic orbital will combine only with the 1s atomic orbital of another atom. Okay, so 1s will not combine with the 2s of the other atom, because 1s and 2s will have the different energies, so they will not combine. So 1s will combine with 1s, 2s will combine with the 2s, like that. Okay, that is the first point. The second one is the combining atomic orbitals must have the same symmetry about the molecular axis. That is only discussed here, right? Whatever the combining atomic orbitals are there, they should have the same energies and the same symmetry. Again, they explained in the different point-wise point. Okay. Here, the combining atomic orbitals should have the same energy, and the combining atomic orbitals also should have the same symmetry. That means, 1 minute, please. Hello, sorry. So combining atomic orbitals, the combining atomic orbital must have the same symmetry about the molecular axis. That means 2pz will combine with 2pz only of other atom. 2px or 2py will not combine with the 2pz. That is only explained in the second point. And the third one is the combining atomic orbitals must overlap to the maximum extent. And we discussed this overlapping concept in the valence bond theory, right? If the extent of the overlapping is more, there will be more stability for the bond formation. If the extent of overlap is less, there is a less stability for the bond formation. Okay, so whichever the atomic orbitals have the similar energy will undergo the maximum overlapping. So if there is a maximum overlapping will be there, now there will be greater formation of the molecular orbitals. So these are the three important conditions for the formation of molecular orbitals. The first one is the combining atomic orbitals should have the same energies. The second one is the combining atomic orbitals should have the same symmetry about the molecular axis. The third one is whatever the combining atomic orbitals, they should undergo the maximum overlap. Okay, these are the three points for the atomic orbitals to combine to form the molecular orbitals. So that when you form the molecular orbitals, they have the two types of molecular orbitals. One is a bonding molecular orbital, the other one is anti-bonding molecular orbitals. And again, we can classify the molecular orbitals into two more types, which is symmetrical around the bond axis, which is not symmetrical around the bond axis. The first classification of molecular orbital is bonding molecular orbitals and the non-bonding molecular orbitals. That is the first classification. Okay. The second classification is based upon the symmetry of the molecular axis. If the molecular axis is symmetry about the, sorry, if the molecular orbitals are symmetry about the molecular axis, they are called as sigma molecular orbitals. Sigma molecular orbitals are symmetrical around the bond axis. And one more molecular orbitals are there, those are called as pi molecular orbitals, which are not symmetrical around the bond axis. Understanding the sigma and pi? Sigma means what? Sigma molecular orbitals are symmetrical around the bond axis. And the pi molecular orbitals are not symmetrical around the bond axis. Okay, sigma molecular orbitals are symmetrical around the bond axis and the pi molecular orbitals are non-symmetrical around the bond axis. So again, one more classification is there, that is a based upon the symmetry. So based upon the energies, we have the anti-bonding molecular orbitals and the bonding molecular orbitals. And based upon the energy symmetry, we have the sigma molecular orbitals and the pi molecular orbitals. Any doubts in these two classification? Any doubts in these two classification?
No, sir.
Understanding or not? Are you understanding or not? Or am I going very fast? Anjali, Abhinay, and Pravalika?
No, sir.
Okay, so next one is the energy level diagram for the molecular orbitals. Just we discussed it only with the one orbital, right, before? That is only with the 1s we discussed it in the before case. So when you are mixing the 1s orbital and 1s orbital, it will form the two molecular orbitals. One is a bonding molecular orbital, the other one is an anti-bonding molecular orbital. Okay. And this is a 1s orbital. See, this is a sigma. Sigma means what? Bonding molecular orbital. If you combine the 1s with the 1s, and both are in the same sign, right? Both are in the same signs. They will form the sigma star 1s. But in the case of anti-bonding molecular orbitals, sigma 1s and sigma 1s will form that electron density on the different side on the molecular axis. So here it will form the unique, same as the, whatever the 1s and 1s is there, but here it will form the electron density different way. One is a positive, other one is a negative. In the case of antibonding molecular orbitals, because of this only, they will have the higher energies. Understand anything? If you take the bonding molecular orbital, I'll explain here. This is the one nucleus of one atom, this is an atom. And this is a nucleus of one atom, and this is one more atom. So when you're combining these two now, it will form like big atom like this. Because whatever the electrons are there in the B atom here, it will be attracted by this nucleus. And whatever the electrons are there here, it will be attracted by this nucleus. So it will form combinedly big nucleus. Okay. So this is the one nucleus, and this is the one more nucleus, and the electrons will be there in between. In the case of bonding molecular orbital, two nucleus will be there, right? Some electrons will be there in between also, so they will attract each other. But in the case of antibonding, there are no electrons between the nucleus, so that positive-positive undergoes the repulsion and the electron-electron undergoes the repulsion, so that only they will have the higher energies. Clear? That's why they have the higher energies, antibonding molecular orbitals. So these are the energy level diagrams for the different atomic orbitals. These are 1s and 1s. It will form sigma 1s and sigma star 1s. When you mix 2pz and the 2pz, it will also form similar to the sigma 1s and sigma 1s. This is a dumbbell shape, right? So it will also form the dumbbell shape. So minus plus and plus minus, both will combine to form bigger shape like this in the case of antibonding molecular orbitals. So it will form again minus plus plus minus, but in the case of this one, both signs will join together and the minus signs will join opposite side, so it will form bigger shape like this, plus minus minus. Okay, this is a bonding, which is more stable. And this is the antibonding, which is a less stable. So this is in the case of 2pz and 2pz along the internuclear axis. This is energy diagram for the 2pz orbital. In the same way, if you take the pi orbitals means which is not symmetrical around the bond molecular axis. So they will combine in the different format. You can see here. This is the bond axis. They're combined also along in the molecular axis, but this is the bond axis here, but they are combining in the, not along the bond axis, they are combining in the vertical line, right? So this is a pi bonding orbitals. So in the case of pi bonding, we have the 2px and 2py. 2px and 2py undergoes the pi bonding. Only 2pz undergoes the, sorry, pz undergoes the sigma bonding in the molecular orbital theory. This is an important point. X and y undergoes the pi bonding, and z orbital undergoes the sigma bonding in the molecular orbital theory. So these are the different structures, energy level structures for the different orbitals. Okay, and if you see the energy level diagram or energy level of the molecular orbital, similarly like atomic orbitals, if you take atomic orbitals now, first sigma 1s2 2s2, next 2p6, next 3s2, according to Hofbauer chart will fulfill, right? Here also for the molecular orbital theory we have one chart, and this is very very important for the exam point of view. This complete chart, compulsory how to remember these points, this order. So whenever there is a question on the exam, it is based upon this order only in the molecular orbital theory. For the oxygen and the fluorine, the order of energies for the molecular orbitals are sigma 1s less than sigma star 1s less than sigma 2s sigma star 2s sigma 2pz will come here. It is only important for the oxygen and the fluorine. Next, after sigma 2pz only, pi 2px equal to pi 2py will come. Then afterwards, pi 2px and pi 2py only, sigma star 2pz will come. Only in this will change. That means here only will change, will happen from this to this. Next, that's all for the oxygen and the fluorine. But remaining other than the oxygen and fluorine, like lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, we have this order we have to follow. Sigma 1s, sigma star 1s, sigma 2s, sigma star 2s. Before sigma 2pz, here it will come pi 2px equal to pi 2py. Okay. Before sigma 2pz, it will come pi 2px equal to pi 2py. Then it will come pi star 2px equal to pi star 2py and sigma star 2pz. This is the order. Understanding, these two orders are very, very important. For the oxygen and the fluorine, sigma 2pz will come before, then pi 2px equal to pi 2py. You can write down these two orders in the classwork notes. But for lithium or beryllium or the boron, carbon, nitrogen, in all the case of these molecules, pi 2px will come before the sigma 2pz. Okay, so this is the energy order for the molecular orbital theory to fill the electrons. Like how you write the electronic configuration for the atomic orbitals, similarly we'll write the electronic configuration for the molecular orbitals in this format. Okay, so we'll also fill the electrons in the molecular orbitals based upon their energies. And these two are the energy orders for the different molecules. For the oxygen and the fluorine, it will have the different order, and remaining all elements will have the different order. Any doubts in this? Any doubts in this? Suppose if we take a If you take oxygen molecule, how many electrons will be there in the oxygen molecule? Oxygen atomic number is 8, right? So each oxygen will have the 8 electrons. Total oxygen molecule will contain 16 electrons. Now we have to distribute the 16 electrons to the different energy levels of the molecular orbitals. So what we'll do, we'll follow this order, because oxygen and fluorine, we have to follow this order. So how we'll distribute? Sigma 1s 2. Next, we'll give to sigma star 1s 2. Then next, after filling sigma star 1s 2, we'll give sigma 2s 2. Then sigma star 2s 2. How many finished? 1, 2, 3, 4. 8 finished. Remaining 8 is left. Next, we'll give to sigma 2pz2, because each orbital will take maximum 2 electrons only, right? Orbital can take maximum 2 electrons. So sigma 2s2, how many finished now? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 10 finished. Then we'll give pi 2px2 equal to pi 2py2. How many finished now? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14. Then we'll write pi star 2p x. Only one we have to give here because both are equal, right? Pi star 2p y equal to 1. So this is the way of writing the electronic configuration for the molecular orbital of oxygen atom. Like how we will write the electronic configuration for the atomic orbital, similarly we'll write the electronic configuration for the molecular orbitals also in this format. Okay, understand? So your homework for today is, so based upon these two orders, write the electronic configuration from lithium to the fluorine. Lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine. That is your homework for today's class. Okay. Any doubts?
No, sir.
So for the lithium molecule, how many electrons will be there? Li2. For lithium molecule, how many electrons will be there? Li2. Okay, skip the lithium. Start with the beryllium. Be2, B2, C2. Here, list is there, right? Beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine. So write down the electronic configuration of the molecular orbitals of all these atoms. Homework is clear for you, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so these are the, this is a very, very important, compulsory one question will come on this topic. And order is also important. And when you're filling the electrons, there are some more factors will come. That is the bond factors. First one is the stability of the molecule. Stability of the molecule will be decided based upon the number of electrons in the bonding molecular orbital and number of electrons in the anti-bonding molecular orbital. So NB is nothing but the number of electrons in the bonding molecular orbital. NB means what? Number of electrons in bonding molecular orbital. And NA means number of electrons in anti-bonding molecular orbitals. If NB is greater than NA, then the atom is very stable. If you say the stability of the molecular orbitals, if the electrons in the bonding molecular orbital is greater than the anti-bonding only, the atom is stable or the molecule is stable. If the NB is less than NA, the molecule is unstable. Okay, if NB is less than NA, the molecule is unstable. So what is this NB and NA first? How can you find out that one? The molecule is stable if NB is greater than NA, and the molecule is unstable if NB is less than NA. Okay, that is the first one based upon the stability of the molecule. The next one is the bond order. Bond order, we have the directly formula is there. If you calculate the NB value and NA value, bond order is nothing but half of NB minus NA. That means number of bonds between the two atoms in the given molecule, that is only the bond order. The number of bonds between the two atoms in the given molecule is called as in bond order. So that is, you can calculate with the help of NB and NA electrons, bond order is equal to half of NB minus NA electrons. So if you got bond order as a 1, then the number of bonds between the two atoms in the given molecule is 1. If the bond order is 2, the number of bonds between the two atoms is 2 in the given molecule. Similarly, bond order is 3 now, the number of atoms in the given molecule, number of bonds between the given molecule is 3. And if you got the bond order zero, that means that atom will not exist at all. If you got half of NB minus NA is equal to zero, that indicates that that molecule will not exist at all. Okay, next one is a bond length. If the bond order increases, the bond length will decrease. That is inversely proportional. Single bond is more having more length than the double bond. Double bond is having more length than the triple bond. And the magnetic nature, the last one. Magnetic nature is nothing but if you have any unpaired electrons, it will show paramagnetic nature. That means the molecule will be attracted by the magnetic substance. If you have there is no unpaired electron in the given molecule, that is called as diamagnetic. That means it is the substance or the molecule is repelled by the magnetic field. Diamagnetic means if there is no unpaired electron in the given molecule. Paramagnetic means if there are unpaired electron in the given molecule. Okay. So these are the different terms which are used in the molecular orbital theory. Any doubts in today's class? Your homework is read the textbook, either SSA textbook or the CBSE textbook on the molecular orbital theory, complete line to line. Okay, once you read the textbook from line to line, you'll understand it easily. And the thing is, this molecular orbital theory is best explained in the textbook itself with the help of neat diagrams and all. So you can understand it easily. That's why I didn't explain the notepad, because the notepad diagram will be confusion only. And you can read the line to line. If you have any doubts, you can ask me in the next class. So how the bonding is done in the diatomic molecules, we'll discuss in the next class. And with this next class, we're going to finish this chapter also. Okay, only small portion is left. So any doubts in today's class?
No, sir.
No, sir.